अरे अरे कितने मंजिल है।
I just changed my workstation because the lighting was just not working.
No worries. So, Gurmeet, are we live? Hello, everybody. Thank you for taking time on a Saturday morning and coming. Madhura, you want to get started?
Yes, Smita. So, as Smita rightly said, thank you everyone for coming in on a Saturday morning for the Bosch session that we are hosting. Myself, Madhura from Indian Lawyers Association, and we are set out to be the largest organizations for Indian lawyers in India as well as abroad. So, currently we have about 45 chapters in India, and there is one in Germany as well. We work for the professional development of our members by way of conducting, hosting different sessions, events, conferences, giving mentoring platforms to young lawyers. Then we also are starting with our legal aid committee, which would help to provide legal assistance for those who need with very little or no cost. So we are proud to associate ourselves with KELP HR for putting together this series, the Bosch Foundation course. I request Smita, who is the moderator today, to begin the session.
Thank you, Madhura, and thank you all of you for coming in. My name is Smita, as Madhura pointed out, and I am the CEO and co-founder of KELP HR. I'm very, very glad to be hosting this foundation series on prevention of sexual harassment at workplace, which has been considered a big, big question mark by a lot of people. People get goosebumps, people are nervous, people are not sure what is their role and responsibility in this whole scheme of thing. So we said, let us break it up. Let us break it up into small, small capsules of understanding this really better. We have huge population in India, and I feel entire corporate, SMEs, small organizations, mom and pop shops, everybody should know their rights and responsibilities. So today is a series where we are trying to understand that as an employer, when I'm conducting a sexual harassment awareness program, what is it that I need to understand or I need to share with my team members? So with me, I have some amazing people here. I have Vasudevan Vishwanath ji. He is here with a whole lot of experience. I have Jyoti Grover ji, who's here again from. So one important aspect here about Jyoti Grover is that she is part of LCC. That is another question mark that we always have, that what does LCC really do or what they should be doing. Okay, so I think we really have somebody whom we would want to talk to. And I have Punita here. She is somebody whom I have worked with for many years now, and she works in the space of spreading awareness. So all three of them do that, right? Vasudevan ji is major in retail industry. Jyoti Grover ji runs employee awareness program, and Punita also does that. So I said, let us all get all three of these senior folks and let us understand that how they can help us. As we know, in if you look at the law says it is employer's responsibility or obligation to create awareness. Okay, and it is pretty silent after that. I keep getting questions like, should it be done annually? What should be explained to an employee? What should they know? Okay, so let's get started. So Vasudevan ji, I'm coming to you first. If you could start with a little bit of about yourself, and then what do you think about the essence of creating employee awareness?
Yeah, thank you, Smita. Good morning, everyone. I'm proud to be associated with the Indian Lawyers Association on this session for raising awareness. There's a very right point. The employer has to, maybe I will say a bit about myself. So I am part of Unilever and Small & Group India. I've been a general counsel and consultant and working for retail industry. I've been an internal committee member for 10 plus years. So my experience remains in prevention rather than addressing, because I don't get into the thing. So I'm also part of a legal advisory firm, Ungender, based on Bangalore legal advisory firm. I'm part of the retail industry partnership. So now let me come to the subject. So the most important thing is the employer's responsibility to raise awareness, whether it is weekly, monthly, yearly. I would say, and I have been practicing that, it's from day one. One, for the existing set of employees, there should be a wide scale awareness program. It need not be on the floor. It can be virtual. It can be through their mobile handset. There could be small programs and sessions. Presentations can be pushed into their WhatsApp messages. I'm talking about existing people. And every establishment, in fact, there is a legal requirement for displaying all the laws, especially the posters. The posters are available. Ready-made posters are available. So the posters are all prominent to display at the workplace where the employees assemble. And for the new employees, it should be part of the joining kit. As a person joins, he goes through a lot of induction, business, HR, company. Why not POSH? It should be part of that. They should be signing off a POSH policy, and they should be inducted with little example questions actually. I think that could resolve most of the problems, for at least for the organized industry. For unorganized industry, we'll have to talk separately. I think we'll deal with it later. So
thank you, Vasudev. That's quite insightful. What I take away from here is that we create awareness about other laws. Why not POSH? Okay. And right from their joining kits, we can include the awareness here. So yeah. Moving on to Jyoti Grover, what do you think about this? And I would really, I'm too excited to hear from LC perspective that you come from. What is it that you think is the importance of having an employee awareness?
Right. I think Vasudevanji actually just put the whole context very well. So I'll just take on from there. When it comes to employee awareness, I think the first piece that one has to definitely keep in mind is the language sensitivity, because we really are diverse countries. So a lot of times, I think organizations just look at English and maybe Hindi or the local state language, but you do have a lot of migration of labor, for example. So language sensitivity is important. And keeping in mind the normalization of certain behaviors or certain conversations and how those actually could be in the realm of sexual harassment under the Act need to be specified. The other piece, which I think from an LC perspective becomes really important, is we really need to know where to go and who's the appellate authority, because we get a lot of cases which ideally should be handled at an IC level. But that doesn't really happen because either there's no faith or they don't really know. Sometimes we also get cases where, let's say the IC has done the investigation, but they're not happy with the result and then they come to LC. So under the Act, there is a provision that if you want to appeal, a lot of people think that they need to go to court. That's not true. Under the Act, in the rules, there is a clear provision to say that if you're not happy with IC and you're not happy with the award, then your appellate authority is actually the labor court. Now with the IR code coming in, and the Industrial Disputes Act and Trade Unions Act and also the Employee Standing Orders Act being merged, there could be other connotations for this particular legislation, because organizations under 300 in terms of employees don't need to have, they don't need to follow the model standing orders, which means they need to create their own rules of misconduct. So today, as I speak, because the new IR code is going to be implemented at every state level, this is going to become really tricky, because POSH has been a central act. with IR code also being a central act, but you know, execution at the state level, how this will sort of get interpreted from a prevention of sexual harassment will need to be seen. A couple of other points. The biggest issue that we have in LC is the way the complaint is worded. Half the time, when you just look at the copy of the complaint, you can't really make out if it's a case of sexual harassment. So in the employee awareness sessions, it's very, very important for employees, and this could be both, you know, the respondent and the complainant, to know exactly, you know, what qualifies as sexual harassment and how do they really word the complaint. And obviously, you know, when you're looking at creating awareness, it's not just about having awareness sessions, because there are a lot of supporting, enabling processes and systems. For example, the culture, how do you conduct meetings? How do you conduct performance feedback sessions? The awareness is not just about the act. It's also about creating a very gender neutral work culture, which unfortunately a lot of organizations don't really pay heed to, especially at the blue collar level. I mean, they may be doing that at the management level, but not really at, you know, the blue collar level. And finally, you know, this is not an year end thing. So how do you make sure that through the year, you know, you're doing your bits? So, I mean, I would even go to the extent of saying, and I've done that with a few organizations, that it's not just that, you know, you do a year end thing with the existing employees and then when they join. But a lot of companies, you know, they have these short gallops or tests during the every quarter. So that definitely needs to be done.
Wow, I had so many takeaways from here. One interesting piece is about appellate. I don't think a lot of awareness programs talk about it. And I think you've brought in an important point here, Jyotiji. In fact, a lot of people have a confusion that LCC is an appellate to IC. I don't know if you've heard that. I have heard lot of it, people saying that, so if I'm not getting a justice from my IC, I'll go to LC. Okay, so that is a basic question that they have. I also hear you saying that, how do you word a complaint? We do not talk about it, because generally what we think is that will be when the complaint comes in, maybe at that point we will talk about. But that is something very interesting that I have heard from you, and it should be a continuous effort. It can't be a one-off effort. It has to be something like in DNA and should work continuously. So this is what I take from your conversation. Okay. So Punita, you have been training a lot of corporates, right? I think you just got off a session where you were doing employee awareness. So what do you think about this?
So I will add to what Mr. Vasudevan and Jyoti Naim said just now, right? I mean, the entire gamut is covered. But the little bit intricacy which I see on the floor when I am doing this training as an external onto corporates is there are two different buckets that gets formed in terms of creating awareness, implementing awareness, and also implementing the act per se. It is one bucket is where it is the management and the set of people who are the implementers of the law, and the second bucket is the employees and that kind of a category. What I feel is there should not be such discrimination, like what Jyoti ma'am said, right? If we are saying that we need to have it throughout the year, we need to make sure that it is uniform across the board, irrespective of whatever hierarchy or designation that this is implemented on. That is one. And when we are talking about awareness, what comes, like you rightly put, is we go on rattling about what is the act talking about, what are the nuances of the act, and so on and so forth. But the basic thing, like how to write a complaint and who is my go-to person. So generally the go-to person is a set of people who are the senior most in the organization, the experienced one. So if I am a person who just feels intimidated by that kind of name or by that kind of designation, then there should be something which tells me, hey, you know what, it is all right, we are here for you, so please feel free, you need to trust this particular team that is put out for you, come and register it, we are here for you. So that along with awareness, the trust that needs to get built on the internal committee, which is there for our people, for every one of us. We need not necessarily run to LCC or to the police station or to the external authority, but we have a system which is inbuilt and we care for you. The way we put it out across there in terms of execution and implementation of this particular act is very, very important. The sensitivity with which we talk about it is important. And the encouragement to make sure that we want to make it zero tolerance, it is not because of compliance, it is because that is the kind of culture and protective and safe environment that we want to build for each other. That should be the intention also behind such awareness.
Awesome, Punita. So I heard you saying that no hierarchy, don't discriminate, consider, you know, don't draw that line. So everybody are employees, including the managing director of the company, right? Yeah, there is a position of an employer which is different and should be treated differently, right? What I also hear you is about building culture, okay? And that is really large. It is, I mean, there's a whole lot of work that needs to go into it, right? Prevention of sexual harassment is just feeding into it, but I agree with you that there's a whole lot of things that needs to work on. Thank you very much for that one. So I'm going back to Vasudevanji, or would we want to speak to Jyoti? Jyoti, if I have to ask you three key things, while you mentioned about Appellate, while you mentioned about, if I have to come to you as an employer, that Jyoti, tell me, how do I design an employee awareness program? What would you tell them? What should be a flow? How do you start? I mean, do you just get everybody into the room and say, okay, today is an employee awareness session and this is what we want to speak about? Or should there be a plan? What are those things that is not negotiable?
So, you know, there is a difference between design and delivery. So I think you will have to, obviously, depending on the audience, from a typical design perspective, you would always want to start with a video, you know, where you actually, or a series of videos where you actually put out there stuff that people have already sort of in their day-to-day working life experienced, and get them to start talking. Starting with, you know, just sharing the key provisions of the act can be very, very daunting, and it can really scare people. So typically that, you know, becomes the delivery sort of mode that I always insist on. Somewhere in the middle, yes, we do talk about the key provisions, who's the aggrieved, you know, who's the complainant, what's the complainant rights, respondent rights, and, you know, what's the timeline. I mean, that's a given. So one doesn't, you know, want to get into too much of that. But I think the biggest piece that employees worry about, whether it's the complainant or the respondent, is, will I really get a fair chance should something happen? Okay, now here, I mean, we talk about principles of natural justice, but again, you know, you can't just throw these words at people that, don't worry, principles of natural justice, we are a quasi civil court. I mean, you know, there is this tendency amongst trainers also to use these terms very loosely. Employees get scared. They don't understand. So how do you, you know, reach out to them in terms of talking through the principles of natural justice in a very easy way? So that's where, you know, the videos really come in handy. And of course, I mean, I'm sure the other speakers will talk about a lot of other things, but one thing that I have seen really, and I've also personally struggled with, is that once, let's say, somebody puts forward a complaint and then wants to maybe withdraw, maybe, you know, there is this whole piece about, you know, the conciliation happening or not happening or whatever. What is the process? And when does it really, you know, really culminate into an inquiry? And then most importantly, there's a whole lot of this discussion about, you know, we will maintain confidentiality. We will make sure that this doesn't, you know, spill over to your performance or your bonuses if, let's say, the, you know, the complaint is null or void. But actually, in reality, it happens. I mean, I've seen so many cases where, I mean, if you track them over like a 5-year period, initial 1 year, not too many cases, 2 years, people become a little more courageous. So they start applying. And then, you know, the aftermath, because you've tried as an employer to maintain confidentiality, you've got your IC trained, you've got NDAs signed. But even then, willy-nilly, the complainant and the respondent do quit the organization. You know, and that's a huge loss. So how do you, you know, really handle that aftermath is is really important, and I don't think organizations are doing enough. And I don't know how often trainers talk about this, you know, and it really bothers me. So that's something. And yeah, pretty much, you know, everything else does get covered. And I think there's one last thing that I'm probably missing out, the aspect of malicious and frivolous complaints, because they also, and in LC also, we are seeing a fair degree of those coming in. Sometimes they're not malicious, sometimes they're not frivolous, sometimes they're just irrelevant because they don't understand what sexual harassment is. So any grievance comes under this. So I think these are some of the pointers that definitely, you know, need to be factored in when you're doing a training.
Awesome. I think sometimes you said this really beautifully. Actually, one of my cases that I'm dealing with, there was some sexual exchange which both the parties were very okay with, but it became a sexual harassment after a point in time. And now we are realizing maybe it was out of anger or out of trying to settle a score that this has become a sexual harassment complaint. Till that time, it wasn't one, right? So this is such a key thing that we have to, you know, while we are telling employees, women employees, that this is your right and responsibility, are we drilling it down saying that you cannot use this law to settle a score, okay? I think that kind of conversation is important, Jyoti, as you rightly said. And you brought out some very beautiful points, like, you know, that we have to ensure that we also concentrate not only on delivery, but also on design. Not only design, but also delivery that we are concentrating on and giving a fair chance, process. What happens? Does it go to a black hole? And I don't know. Then tariq pe tariq pe tariq happens or what? So that is an important aspect that, no, this law is more detailed than any other law in India. So this aspect, actually yesterday I was doing a comparison between India law and US law on prevention of sexual harassment. And I realized that ours is a very, very exhaustive law. Nowhere it is mentioned. You know, so a lot of times we say, oh, we are so backdated, but I thought it was a brilliant news for me when I was doing this, that ours is a most exhaustive law. So going back to Vasudevanji, what do you think if when you are delivering a class, which are those aspects that you would want to concentrate on?
Yeah, see, my workflow is a very, very differential, diverse force from a light, starting from MBA at HR level, CEO level, and there are non-graduates at field level people who are working in the retail shop. Maybe they can understand English. Few lines, not definitely a legal language. Yes, you communicate in their own language, most commonly Hindi. Other language is very difficult for you to translate and explain. But when you're trying to explain the legal definition, they get lost. So you focus on practical examples of small things, actually, like what happens if this incident is done, or what happens when you send a message of WhatsApp at the right time, at the wrong time. A message sent on office time, a sent on office hours. Now somebody has a WhatsApp there. She is all right to get a circulation of a WhatsApp. A mild joke, actually. But same joke sent at 10:30 at night. The mobile is an instrument kept open at home, actually. The family sees it. Then what could turn out to be it, actually? Correct. If somebody asks family, husband or whoever it is, what is this kind of message you are getting? Who is that person? Then the perspective gets changed. Actually. So I try to explain to them in a very, very, very simple field term, not boring, and encouraging them with instances. These are the instances. We do not see who is at power. We only see whether the thing is right or wrong. Second, we are not believing in giving a penultimate punishment of termination. We want to resolve issues. The more it is conciliation, more it is better for both people. We at the best transfer the person to places on those cases so that nobody loses job, nobody loses their reputation. Reputation is very, very important, equally for the respondent and the respondent as well, actually, because his reputation is also equally important. We see that. And Jyoti was talking about local compliance efforts and all, laudable, very good. In fact, I think how many companies are aware, or how many people are using this handbook of sexual harassment published by the Government of India, Ministry of Women. It's a very, very, in fact, I learned a lot of examples from that, actually. It is available on web. So at least companies who are not wanting to spend or who cannot afford to spend money, they can at least print and give it to the people actually. You can't tell the people access it, correct? Because nobody wants to read it. And maybe from that, they can, the HR and the learning and development team can just give 10 points from that, drive it actually. So these are the things I do. Most important thing is, you know, the culture we said. Organization's culture is very, very important. It should set an example because it should align with your personal culture. And then it builds the character of the employees. And both combines, it brings into competence. A lot of people think behavior is something like a shirt you wear and remove. You go to the office, you wear a shirt of behavior. Then you go to a party, you wear a different party shirt. Maybe you can change shirt. Behavior should always be uniform all the time. At least off the places I've seen, it happens in parties. Over a drink, when people dance, socially, yeah, women is okay for dancing. Then these people take advantage of that. That's for, you know, one step beyond. So that is where the issues happen, actually. So I think we should take an example from this, actually. The more you raise awareness, the burden is not on the company. The burden is on the employees to follow. The more you raise awareness amongst the men than women, again, your responsibilities are lessened. For that, you need to have a focus group, HR, not necessarily a general HR, from L&D, and from set of business people. You should have a combined group who can always find out a way, continuously cascading the examples for the people.
Awesome, Vasudevanji, you remind me of behavior, and they blame it on alcohol if something goes wrong, saying, you know, I was drunk, she was drunk, and this happened. So I was discussing this with one of my clients about consuming alcohol and misbehaving. So she gave me a very nice thought, which I'm still mulling over, and I'm not sure if there is a research on this. So that thought was that people do not misbehave when they consume alcohol, but we all have masks, okay? We all wear masks. Alcohol only drops that mask. Yes. So the real you comes out. It was such a brilliant thought because, you know, the real you, you're more lighter, you're not controlling your, you know, the real you, and you display it. So alcohol basically shows your real you, which was a very brilliant thought, and I still hold it to myself. Yeah, Punita, you just got out of the session. Tell me five things you told them about in prevention of sexual harassment.
So what I generally try to do in the sessions is I just make sure that whoever is attending, irrespective of the category that they come from or whatever class they come from in terms of factory people, laborers. So the session is across the board, right from our blue collared or the CEOs to the local carpenters, right? So what I make sure is I make sure that I give them the gamut of the POSH Act. They need not know the definition per se as what the government is saying or what the act is saying in that many different words, but I break it into easy understandable few words which they can have in their hand thick fingertips and recognize it. So basically I make sure that they recognize what is an inappropriate behavior and recognize in such a way that it is, in their understanding, it is from the person on whom the receiver is receiving it. It is never about the person who is doing an inappropriate behavior. It depends or it changes from a person to person who receives this behavior because everybody's tolerance level is different. Okay. For me, if I say a handshake is just a similar handshake, but maybe for you, this handshake could be somewhere you feel that I am doing this, you know, maybe I'm putting an incorrect pressure. So it depends, right? It's always about the receiver. So I make it a point that they understand it from that perspective. Okay. Secondly, what I do is they need to know, who is the person that they need to go and report it to? And it is also their responsibility to take the first step of stopping this behavior and not wait for an IC team or a supervisor or a manager or a mother or a father or anybody out there who are a little bit senior to them to come and stop it for them. Okay. The first step is they need to recognize and they need to put a stop to it. So I always say it is, you know, recognize, report, and stop it. Okay. So you should not just wait for someone else to come into this, right? And at the same time, another important thing which I always make a point is to check out, and this has come from Kelp, I would say, okay, that before they get into the session, right, I always ask them, have you gone through your posh policy? So everybody, any employee, should make sure that he or she knows their posh policy, because it is their right to know it. They may be knowing their leave allowance policy, they may be knowing their travel policy, all the other policies, insurance policies, but when you ask posh, acha aisa kuch hai kya, is something existing like this? That is the kind of feedback I get 90% of the time, I should say. Yeah, I mean, it is bad, but yeah, that is the scenario. So I make sure I tell them, you know what, take a day more, read it and come. And if you have not read it, attend the session, please go and read. Understand what should be your right. You should know what is to be done in case you happen to have this kind of a behavior, in case you happen to witness this kind of a behavior, or whether you are having any of this harasser behavior. This is very important, right? Everybody needs to check on themselves. And it's a beautiful exercise which Kelp does as a reflection behavior of on a person, right? So, and I am a big fan of that particular behavior, which I give them as a homework. So it's beautiful. So I try to do all of this. And always, like Jyoti ma'am and sir said, right, what important factor is, we tell them about sexual harassment. So people take whatever they take, and then there will be a workplace harassment behavior, and then they will term it as a sexual harassment behavior, right? So it is important that your training covers that as well, as to what is workplace discrimination, gender discrimination, and workplace harassment vis-a-vis what is sexual harassment. It is important aspect to cover that. Yeah, so that is pretty much
awesome. Awesome, Punita. So what I hear from you and for the audience is that what she concentrates on recognizing that whether you are being sexually harassed. I would like to share my tale. Way back in 1997, when I was working, there was some behavior around me, which now when I sit back and reflect, was sexual in nature. But what did I do about it? Nothing, because I was not sure whether it was sexual harassment, or I thought it was way of life. This is how every woman must be going through this. That was my first job, right? So are we training people to identify whether that is sexual harassment? That is what she does. And I like the way you said, recognize, stop it, and report, right? So the three things that, you know, you leave. So what I've also noticed, and Punita, what you do rightly is, give them some tips. You know, people will remember five things that you have to do, or three things you have to do. You know, it just gets registered quickly. I think that is a beautiful methodology or beautiful thing that you do. And review your own policy, know your rights and responsibility. That is something I think great, super duper. And another thing is about reflecting your own behavior. Okay, we all think that this I won't do, or this is not me. Right? This won't happen to me. Okay? It's a good idea to step back and think through and reflect your own behavior. Brilliant. So, Punita, just continuing this conversation, I would want to know, is there any case that you can think of which could have stopped, blown out of proportion if we would have done an very good job of creating awareness? Can you think of any case, any example, anything that you would want to share here?
Yeah. So like I said, right, creating this awareness is of prime importance. So it doesn't, I believe it should not be restricted only to employees or only to organization. Like in the beginning, Vasudevan sir said, right, it is, there are different class of people who fall under this gamut, right? So it is important that everybody are covered and they understand what is this sexual harassment behavior. Okay, it can happen in my house, it can happen to me on the road or anywhere. So I have, I have been witnessing certain behaviors which would be like, you know, like Jyoti ma'am said, right? The language that people speak, right? It comes from wherever I come from. For a certain sect of people, abusive language is the beginning and the full stop, and then it's absolutely okay for them, and then they feel comfortable and they feel as if they are in their own, their skin feels like in their own skin, right? Now if we tell them that, okay, these are not acceptable by a certain set of people, then you need to understand it from that receiver's perspective and stop that. Okay, so I have seen behaviors or been witness to such a thing which went beyond becoming a scandal, wherein such abusive words as a behavior or inappropriate touch. The touch was okay for X person, but the touch was not okay for Y person. But then the person did not say it because it was from a power position. Okay, so that is very important. So when any sort of behavior comes to you from a power position, the other person who is receiving it becomes, is unable to even do anything about it, right? So yeah, had it been told before, or had the person been made more aware, I guess, they would not have undergone so much of trauma in their life, and we could have possibly stopped it much, much earlier. So like I said, it need not be there at corporate, okay? It should begin from home. The right kind of behavior that you should have should start from home. It need not be that a corporate is, you go to corporate, you go to work, or you go to college and there is an IC who will come and teach you, okay? The parents at home or everybody associated with you in and around should be able to tell you to identify and recognize the right behavior or a wrong behavior. And applaud the current education system where, even a kindergarten child is being educated on what is an inappropriate, a good touch or a bad touch, and they have been told, right? Otherwise, I would say, like Smita, right? In our school days, it was never done. It was a taboo to talk on this subject, right? But nowadays we are doing better, but I feel that we still need to do more better.
Thank you. So you strongly feel that creating awareness could reduce the mental trauma a person would have otherwise borne. So I kind of, without naming it, I think you took us through one case that you must have dealt with where there was an intervention required much earlier. And or if that person knew their own rights and responsibilities, that person wouldn't have gone through it, right?
Right.
Absolutely. As you said, dining table conversation, open conversations are important to change the way we all think. Our mindset needs to open up. Okay. So we should have these open conversations going forward. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you so much. So coming back to Jyoti ji, what do you think? Do you remember of any specific case you think, I wish there were, was something more, I generally sit back after every case and think how this could have been avoided. So that is what is impending me to ask all of you, that are there any specific case you think that could have avoided, or we should be doing some work in this kind of a space to not have sexual harassment cases coming up? Awareness can make that difference.
Yes. So actually, there are just so many cases, but I'm just going to talk about a recent one. Just to give you a little bit of the background. So here, this is a company in the travel and tourism space. And the complainant is a young person, about 28 to 30 years old. And she joins this company. It's like a startup. She joined the company and doing really well. The company is founded by these three brothers, and one is the CEO, one sits in the US, and the third one is like a non-acting director. Her complaint is with this last guy, the non-acting director, and on numerous occasions, he's kind of, accosted her. So initially she complains to her supervisor. The supervisor hears her out. There is probably a mail exchange, and she says, okay, I'll bring it up, with my manager. So she brings it up with the manager. The manager goes to the HR head. The HR head kind of tells the manager, does not really, talk directly to the complainant. And all of this is not a formal complaint. It's just that point is when, the murmurs are beginning to happen. She's uncomfortable. She's also talking about, okay, I think I should resign because, that guy is the CEO's brother. So there's only that much that the company will do. Now, the company does not have an IC. Like I said, it's a startup, 30, 40 people in place at that point in time. So, the expectation is, for example, the supervisor, the manager, the HR head perhaps to get together and, you know, do some stuff. What does the HR head do? Through mails or through conversations, he's just letting the complainant know, don't worry, I will take care. Now that don't worry, I will take care is just a verbal assurance, not directly coming to the complainant. He may or may not have spoken to the CEO. He may or may not have spoken to the accused. He says he did. Okay. Now, all of this is going on and there is a couple of weeks of no action. Also, fortunately, you know, the person is not really, again, you know, being as much of a harasser. So things are pretty much under control. And then again, it begins. This time around, the complainant sends a formal complaint. Now, here was the time where the HR head should have actually stepped in and probably done a lot of things. You know, maybe first talk to the complainant, set up the IC, made sure that, you know, the matter was taken. And this is where I think the power play also comes in, because people think it's, you know, because there has not been a very extensive case of inappropriate touch. There have just been suggestions and, you know, a simile of like quid pro quo that, you know, you should spend time with me and I can really help you grow and you're doing very well. You know, so those kind of conversation is beginning to happen. The girl is still uncomfortable, but nobody is really taking charge. Eventually, on like one of the big trigger points, she actually finally sends a formal mail to the CEO. What does he do? Chances are that even he didn't know the consequences of what he did, because he just throws away the complaint, terminates people on the ground. The company is a mess right now. They were into their Series A funding. They haven't probably got that. You know, the business was actually until December of last year doing really well. And then it's kind of just fallen flat. What for? Just because the HR head, the CEO, and the so-called, you know, and I know that in this case, the CEO can't get away with saying the HR head didn't form the IC, the HR head didn't create the policy. So what can I do? You know, because as an employer, he has to make sure, especially, and this is a message mostly for startups, you know, because we have a lot of these people with compliances, and there are other compliances, but they completely forget about Bosch. And when they do come across something like this, it's really not there. And I'm like really, really shocked, because one tried so hard. Now, by the time that, you know, and then what happened in this particular case is the legal team got involved. Under Bosch, when proceedings are happening, we don't allow the lawyers, you know, but if you look at the tenor of the way the complaint was written, the way the respondent, you know, started doing, in fact, points that we haven't spoken about, stuff like, you know, evidence, stuff like witnesses, the kind of, you know, crazy stuff we had to go through, because the evidences were all tampered. The witnesses, you know, half 80% of them were hearsay witnesses. So how do you really, you know, and the whole company got involved. You know, all the employees got involved. So many people lost their jobs. It was really sad. Now, all this could have been avoided if the HR head and the CEO had been a little sensible and mature about the whole thing.
Absolutely. So, yes. Even for startups, people say, oh, you know, I hear this a lot saying, okay, us as a small company, we just don't want too many things to do with. We don't want to put that seed in people's mind saying sexual harassment, you know, there is a law for sexual harassment, we have to do this policy, all right? So, no, you know, we have loads of examples. If you look at the helka.com is almost on the similar lines that the story that Jyotiji just narrated, right? So I keep saying this to all who all we meet, that, you know, getting sexual harassment complaint is okay. Pushing it under the carpet is not okay. Not acting on it is not okay. Okay. And please create awareness. So I get a lot of pushback saying it is like a can of worms. We are sitting on ticking bomb because we created awareness. No, it's a myth. It's a myth. That means, yes, there will be some things coming up, but then it will clean up your system. please go ahead and create awareness. Thank you for that story, Jyoti ji. Vasudevan ji, any story that or case that you can think of?
Yeah, I can think of a case where it is a giant retail industry. In fact, they have an excellent setup at their central. The regional committees usually are namesake setup. It's a trivial complaint. A store like manager level person is trying to have a quid pro quo with a person, a merchandiser, who is often asking for leave or permission, etc. So he was trying to ill-treat her and misbehave with her, sort of sexual harassment. The moment she raised it and put a complaint, the store thought, all right, she's a temporary employee, so why to take the hassles? Terminate her. And then it starts. When she has made a complaint and the local committee is also met her, but they're saying, no, nothing is proved. So therefore we are terminating. And there was some counter complaint on her pilfering, you took something from the store, etc., etc. It went through the whole TV for 15 days. And the local, the Canada versus non-Canada issues happened here and all this thing, reputation. People at top level from including myself has to intervene, get into that set, initially set a confidence in her actually. And finally it was resolved. I could say there was another instance where a person, her private I would say more private photographs were there in her mobile. Somebody took it and circulated in a WhatsApp group to about 200 people. And midnight somebody is receiving a WhatsApp from her own name. People got shocked. And next day she comes to know that so many WhatsApp have gone from my distance. It was in Northeast actually. So her family came to know and she attempted suicide actually. So thankfully, at least by then we got to know about it and we have to visit the place and take place. But we resolved it. We had to find the culprit and things like that. See, there have been instances where one, either it is not treated properly, or there is a over-treatment. Actually, there's sometimes jerk reaction, knee-jerk reactions, they don't give the opportunity to the respondent as well. Respondent also should have equal opportunity, unless it deserves the nature of the complaint, reverse. There should not be a penal punishment of termination. There has been cases, a person is inquired insensitively in a room, a lot of people comes to know. He attempted suicide, but he survived. He's in a multinational organization. So everything should be very, very, very sensitive. It doesn't matter. The line manager comes to know, the HR people. It is not something, normal flow of system where everybody should know what's happening. If it comes to the committee has to simply say there is a complaint, we are looking into that. They don't have to circulate what is that complaint, who is it respondent, what is the offences. That is where a lot of people do a mistake. They circulate, then therefore thereafter it cannot be retracted actually. The communication should be very, very specific people. And how do a person files a complaint? That was discussed actually. A lot of people write some four lines, then you ask for evidence, say they don't keep evidences actually. So I think organizations should have a template. Template doesn't mean, it should be a government-like forms, form borrower. That should not happen. It should be a very flexi template. Somebody helps them. On this format, you try to put. If you don't have anything, fine. As far as possible, put this in this format. And internally, you, for your reference, note down who all knows about it, whatever witness and all these things. Keep things ready so that you don't lose it. So that should help, actually. There should be a flexi template. And again, I'm reiterating that the POSH should be part of joining, not thereafter. Thereafter, it should be reiteration. Joining kit, of course, joining kit is 100 pages. Everybody signs and forgets. I myself, I ask people, 90% people ask, what is POSH? Yeah, I signed some forms, actually. There were some 10 pages in that. So they exactly sign. I tell them, if a performance is not good, maybe the company can give an option to you. Your terms of salary and all negotiable, but there is non-negotiable contract for you, it's POSH. Please go and read again, because on this, there is no compromise. You could be a CEO, you could be a gold for the company, but there is nothing like that. So that kind of thing should come. It should be part of L&D and more emphasis should come actually. It's better that they are aware actually. They are given an opportunity of preventing it.
Awesome. Vasudevan, what you remind me of something that we speak in our awareness programs is about telling victims or telling people who are undergoing sexual harassment that you are not the reason for somebody else's bad behavior. So stop blaming yourself. Okay, yes. I think that is a very key message, because in our, even, you know, ICs should be told that you cannot make a person feel bad if she's complaining about something. That did you wear a short dress? Did you give him any signals? Why did you do this? You shouldn't have done that. These are not a great set of questions. And we have to also keep talking about it in our employee awareness program, saying that as a victim, do not blame yourself. Please stop doing that. Do not cross-question your behavior, because you were not wrong. Somebody else was wrong, and you cannot be blamed for that behavior. So that is one thing that I hear from you. I would want to share my experience also, that when we discuss about awareness, I realize that a lot of people who are bordering to sexual harassment, the harassers, also get a fair warning to back off. Okay. So it, the reflection that Punita spoke about, right? It is a fair, I think in my cases I've seen, I wish we had done that reflection with this person. We wouldn't have been sitting and handling this particular case. This wouldn't have come to this stage, right? So these are some things that I have experienced. So now I would like to just quickly go we are almost at the end of the session, but I would want to understand the current situation of work from home, okay? So which are those ways or methods that you strongly feel should be used to create awareness? Because we are not meeting physically, there are no classroom sessions. Okay, so what can be done about it? Anybody, I mean.
Yeah. Okay. See, again, it doesn't matter where from you walk, actually. Behavior is behavior, actually. And now here, the responsibility is, as always, either side. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's either side. So each person may have a small one-room kitchen or room, depending upon their this thing. They have to seclude a place for their work. An organization also, as far as possible, have their connect predetermined times so that they are comfortably sitting there with a, I'm not saying formal attire, with a reasonable attire, then meetings are there. And it's just confined to business. Yes, sociable questions are fine, but it doesn't go too far. And there is something called odd hours of, in the guise of work. You can't be following with people at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, especially women, because they have dual responsibility at home, actually. So it's a voluntary code that each organization should adopt. Like today, Maharashtra government is saying they are going to have, they announced a dress code for their office people, actually. I'm not saying all these things are maybe overdoing, but it's all, whatever is voluntary code helps. You have to understand voluntarily what to wear, how to behave. Office meeting, differentiate this. If you're not comfortable in taking the call, you can always tell, no, I'm not ready. And the conversation should be very, very professional. It's like a behavior, no? Whether you work from home or office, doesn't matter. A behavior always stands with you, ethically. Yeah.
Thank you, Vasudevanji. Punita was raising.
Yeah. I will just add on to what he said. He actually covered it so beautifully. So like he said about behavior, right? When it is work from home, it is always taken for granted whether, you know, whether I am into the call or I'm asking somebody to join into the call. It is like, are yaar, work from home, right? Maybe I'll just switch off the video and then let me do whatever I am doing parallelly. I'm good at multitasking. But we forget that there is a chance or a possibility, like when you're on this particular thing, your hand may go away, your video could get switched on, or your mute could get switched on, and then you are not there at work, neither are you doing what you're supposed to be doing otherwise, right? So everybody needs, so it is my responsibility to make sure that if I'm working from home also, whatever timelines, like Mr. Vasudevan said, right, I need to stick to it. Another important thing is work from home. I have seen many posters or many chat messages that has been that has been coming as work from home. You know, people are half dressed. It's only the upper part which is like dressed formally. The lower half of the body is like in different shapes and forms, and they are either in, you know, lying down on a sofa. Then only because this is visible, they are doing whatever. What I recommend is, it's a good practice to make sure that you bucket your timelines accordingly. If it is work, then let me have that mode. Let me have that surrounding which will keep me, give my 100% of productivity because it is work. So at work, if it is at home, then let me be at home and do that. And like he said, right, women, they are doing multitasking. They're taking multiple roles, right, of a mother, of managing the kids' online sessions and adjusting. Even if that is happening, we need to remember that we are 4 or 5 of us in a small room. Do your calendaring appropriately. If you cannot come on video, inform in advance that it would be inappropriate for you to come on video. So only can audio be a fine methodology. And always, very important, which I keep saying, which I had been saying since March to many organizations, is make sure that you have these good practices written as a part of your maybe policy, or I don't know what to name it as. Maybe Smita, you can word it properly, but make sure that you communicate this in advance to your employees. They need to know what is a good behavior or a bad behavior if they have not understood by themselves. It is always okay to reiterate it and tell them that, okay, these are the best behaviors. If you are a manager, if you are a employee, if you are a support staff or whatever that is that you are, right? Apart from that, make sure that your posh policy, because of the current COVID situation, gets updated with this work from home scenario as well. Okay. Otherwise, we don't want as an organization to be on the back foot saying that, oh my God, I forgot to do this, right? The government or the act doesn't say this, but then why not be proactive and create a better place for everybody?
Sure. Brilliant. Great points, Punita. You're giving a lot of ideas. Thank you so much. So Jyoti ji,
I think most of the stuff has been covered, so I won't repeat that. Just a couple of things. One, because of the situation, a lot of employees may feel that, okay, so now, even if there is a case, how is the company really going to handle it? So I think very important for employees to know that it is possible to run virtual inquiries, and they will still get the same process, and everything that will happen will be virtual. But because virtual inquiries happen, you still can't, compromise on the way it's getting done, which means, you know, you will not allow the husband to sit next to the wife when the examination is happening, for example. So those rules need to be in the awareness that, you know, get done on how to conduct and how the virtual inquiries will be conducted needs to be really put out there. When it comes to boundaries, really, we spoke about timing, clothes, language, you know, what is permissible, what's not permissible. But I think something which I'm finding a lot of my clients do, and I think it's working very well, is to start the culture of, really asking out there, especially if these are odd timings, you know, can we have a meeting, let's say, at 10 p.m. tonight? Now, the moment you put, the can we, it's like seeking permission. So even for the lady employee, you know, it doesn't come across as a diktat that, oh, my manager is saying that he needs to have a con call at 10, you know. So I think those are some of the subtle changes that I see employers making. One last point, which I think is very, very important. Thanks to COVID, I think there is a lot of, cases of domestic abuse and cases of depression have been reported. And willy-nilly, the managers are becoming, quack counselors. And they are reaching out to their employees and they're trying to sort of support them. The intention is fine, but at what stage will the intention convert into, you know, a seeming case of, you know, getting too close to the private space? Very, very difficult to say. So there have been a couple of cases that I have, personally gotten involved in, where, you know, the managers actually were genuinely trying to help, but it became a very complicated process.
That is exactly what I remember speaking yesterday in one of our conversations, that please check in. So as a manager, you have to be empathetic. You know, empathy is the key in current situation. Be empathetic, but do not be interfering. Okay. And please check on body language. Okay. Check on the tone of the person. If the person is uncomfortable, take it as a cue. You don't have to have a no for an answer. If somebody is uncomfortable, you will get to know. Okay. Just watch out. So these are something which is brilliant. And, you know, men push back saying, oh, you know, we don't have sixth sense, or only women have sixth sense. So I keep pushing them back saying that's not true. Brains almost are constructed similarly. If I'm angry at you, you'll get to know that I'm angry at you or upset at you, right? So you really you have to keep your antennas on. So we are almost at 12 plus. There are a few questions here. So Aparna is asking Jyoti, ma'am, can you please share how to reach out to LCC, any process or coordinates?
Right. So Aparna, under the Act, every district is, required to set up an LC. Now, the setting up the LC, the mandate is with the district commissioner. And typically what he would do is he would either delegate the ADC to become the district officer, and then the LC would get constituted. So the LC typically would be there in every district. Of late, we are finding that there are states who are becoming very, very active in it. This wasn't the case a couple of years ago. I come from the Gurugram district. And at least in the NCR region, I know that, there are a lot of LCs now. So if you were to, the first thing you need to do is to identify where and which district, depending on whichever state you're in, which district, does your organization lie. Always a good idea to go across and meet the district officer. You will be surprised that, you know, many districts will not have an LC, but when you have gone and met them, then is when they will start cobbling up. Okay, now the LC has to be created. So difficult to say, therefore, coordinates. But yeah, in terms of the process of forming the LC, what the district officer really does is, and this is something that I've seen in most cases, the chairperson is always somebody of repute. Either she's either from the ruling sort of party of that particular state, or she is, you know, a known lawyer and so on. Then there are two other members. Typically, they come from a background of, working in women, sort of on women causes. It's always good to have somebody with a legal background. And I think the best LC that I have seen is somebody with a civil law background and somebody with a criminal background. The idea here is not to overawe. It's just that what happens, especially where LC is concerned, not so much maybe for IC, we have to be very careful in the way we do our orders, because a lot of cases eventually end up going to High Court. And as you know, the courts don't really have the powers to reopen a case. But yes, most cases that go are to do with violation of process. So that is why we have to be very careful that whatever orders are passed and whatever investigation happens is done as per process, so the cases don't unnecessarily go to High Court, which is not good for, you know, anyone, either for the government or for, you know, the parties. So that's what we need to be careful about. So, and then there's always an ex officio member, again, from the bureaucracy. And then there is somebody, you know, representing the underprivileged or the backward classes. So typically any LC will have five members, one chairperson and four other members. The quorum as an IC is always three. And honestly, the ex officio members, just by name, they don't really participate too much. And yeah, so it's really, that's how it works.
Thank you for that. Veena is saying, dual relationship at work must be avoided. Veena, can you, I didn't get the question. Did any of y'all get the question? Dual relationship, I'm not sure what does that mean.
I think she's just agreeing to, you know, some of the conversations we were having.
That's okay. Right. That's right, Jyotiji. I just agreed with you when you said that, you know, nowadays there's domestic violence is happening and people are noticing, and then, you know, they're turning into counselors. So that's what I was highlighting, that it is happening, you know, even everywhere, actually, in colleges, schools, the teachers are getting into the personal lives of the students and not realizing how, you know, it's going to affect them as, in their, you know, teacher-student relationship or employee or employer relationship. So that's what I just agreed with what you said.
I just want to add here, Veena, because you talked about student teachers, because I'm also very, very active in the POXO space. And so, you know, where children are concerned, especially high school children, because they're going through this in a very crazy way. So they are resorting a lot to social media, Insta and, you know, Bumble and so on. And what they are not realizing is that under POXO, they could actually, with the kind of nonsense that's going on, even where teachers are concerned, they could actually be charged under POXO. And things could get really ugly.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks for that information.
Okay. Smita is saying, my namesake, I missed the part where Jyoti ji was talking about appellate authority and changes in the new law.
So I'll just re-clarify. IC is the go-to place for all employees, other, you know, where the aggrieved is maybe a colleague. And I think the big question here that happens is that at what stage does LC get involved? At what stage does police get involved? When do you go to court? Now, if you look at the law, anything which is happening as a case of sexual harassment is when it goes to the IC, it's only those cases which typically would qualify under, you know, the act, and those are typically in the nature of a civil case. So where there are cases of stalking, kidnapping, and stuff like that, you know, better authority to go to would be, you know, go file an FIR and then proceed as per the normal process.
Yeah.
The LC will come to play only when the case is against an employer. And more often than not, as LC, I think we spend a lot of time trying to establish that what is our jurisdiction to take up the case? Is the case really against the employer? So that's, the LC is not an appellate authority. It's only handling cases where the respondent or the accused is the employer. Don't have time to get into the definition of employer, so maybe you can do that at some other stage. Now, let's say IC proceedings are not something that the complainant is happy about or the respondent is happy about. The appellate authority in this case is twofold. You could either go and appeal and go to the, you know, to the trial court or the summary court, whatever. Actually going to the labor court is better. Now, there are a lot of case judgments where, you know, proceedings of the IC have been questioned. And in a lot of states, TCS is, I think, one case that I remember, this was last year. So the employee has gone to the labor court. The labor court has in fact taken very good response to it. Unfortunately, many labor courts don't know about their own authority. But yes, if you're not happy about IC award, implementation, whatever be the case, labor court becomes the go-to party rather than going to the court. If it's a case of, let's say, quid pro quo, etc. Obviously, if it's a case of you know, attempted rape and so on, you would still want to go to the criminal authority. One last point here. You know, when you look at appellate authorities, you have to be very careful that just because it's mentioned in the act, it doesn't mean that particular authority knows its mandate. So half the time you will, as an employer, you need to help the employee, you know, establish. So if you walk into a labor court, the guy may actually just diss you away because he has no clue, and or maybe he doesn't want to take that case. The piece about the new IR code, I'm only at this point conjecturing, because the IR code has made some very sweeping changes with reference to the Employee Standing Orders Act and the Industrial Disputes Act. So what has happened is that under the Industrial Disputes Act earlier, you know, the definition of workman was typically akin to that of a blue collar worker, but now it's a much far reaching definition, and disputes under that could be anything. So I'm also waiting to actually see how this gets rolled out and whether sexual harassment, you know, how that plays out with respect to the POSH Act. So it's still not very clear.
Yeah.
I just have to wait and watch.
So did you, one last question or any of the panelists can respond to. How does the she box play into act? Where does this fit in?
So the she box, I mean, sorry, maybe.
No, I will just expanding the question that is it an appellate? Is it, can people, when they don't get a justice from IC, can they go to appellate or can they take it as the first level of complaint?
So she box is actually the first level of complaint. And let's say, you know, unfortunately, the way the she box is curated, the details of the complaint are never that visible. So when there is a complaint coming into the she box, the administrator from she box will send it to the relevant LCs. Okay. I'm not sure if there is a complaint against a company because the she box administrator is not evaluating that is this a case for LC or is this a case for IC. For whatever reasons, the cases just come to the respective LC of the region. And then when the LC looks at the complaint, typically we would call up and find out first to establish jurisdiction. And then we end up doing the job of the employer and telling the person that boss, ye complaint jo hai, this is more relevant and you need to apply to your IC. And then we also take on that role and we sometimes contact the IC of that company and say, okay, you know, there is this employee for whatever reason has come to us. So SheBox is not an appellate authority. It's more the place where if the employee is not comfortable, not sure how the IC is going to handle, they put in the complaint.
Yeah, I completely agree with it. SheBox is a circuitous process actually. Rather, the company should maybe encourage boxes to be put in their main branches or the field places where the employees are encouraged to put the complaint, either directly by email online or a box can be also put. But anonymous is not the right route. The person has to identify herself and then put the complaint. Anonymous doesn't help. That's my view.
All right. So I think that if anybody else has any questions, they can send it to us and we'll try and respond to it separately. We've come to the end of the hour. I had some awesome learnings. Thank you very much for your time today, all of you. Punita, Jyoti, Vasudevan ji, thank you very, very much. And thank you very much all the participants for joining in and listening in and asking some brilliant questions. Okay. Madurai, would you want to close the session?
Yes, Smita. What a wonderful learning on this Saturday. And Smita, as usual, I would like to congratulate you for a fantastic moderation. And to all our participants, so ILA has a POSH committee recently announced. Any one of us who would like to contribute by way of writing articles, blogs, or helping us create some videos. So we have a pan-India presence and the outreach also is quite huge. So it's great to have some informative and useful interactions at this level. So if anyone is interested, please feel free to reach out to us. I'll also send a separate email related to this. And that's all for the day. Thank you so much. Have a great weekend.
Thank you to Aile and to Smita.
Yeah, thank you very much for inviting. It was a great informative session. Thanks, Atan.
Thanks for the opportunity because sharing is caring. We always believe in sharing. We learn more in a practical sharing. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Gurmeet, will you stop recording and Facebook Live also?
Sure, Smita.